Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming out. I appreciate it. Thunderous applause. Thank you. Today, we're going to be discussing attribution chain analysis and what's required to establish chain analysis as it relates to attribution. My name is Will Gragido. I'm the senior manager of RSA First Watch for the threat research and intelligence team within RSA. We focus on subnational, state-sponsored, and criminal activity. I've been in the industry for about 20 years. I've written 2 books on the subject. I'm happy to be here. Okay, let me get this to work. Sorry about that. We're going to discuss attribution. It's fitting since so often in recent media, the topic has come up again and again and again with organizations varying from large media conglomerates to large international pharmaceutical organizations to large technological development organizations and social media organizations having been compromised recently, and with a report that I think is seminal having been released last week that discusses in gross detail attribution as it relates to threat actors. I'm sure none of you guys read that report, right? We're also going to discuss whether or not attribution matters. And this is a topic that I think is important because many people tend to fall on 2 sides of the argument, that attribution doesn't matter and it matters more, it matters more that we focus on what's occurring rather than on who's behind what's occurring. I tend to focus on and believe that both points are legitimate and that we need to understand who our adversaries are in order to understand how to combat them. We'll also discuss what can be gained through the understanding of attribution analysis. And can we gain significant enough information to actually fight the good fight and defend against threat actors? And what we need to consider before we start the attribution process. And that's important. I think we spend a lot of time talking about attribution. We spend a lot of time talking about threat actors and profiling threat actors and what that means from a TTP perspective and what it means to enterprises and customers on a global basis. But we don't often talk about what we can gain in terms of innate knowledge from the process of establishing attribution. So before we dive in and start discussing threat attribution, we need to discuss and consider attacks and adversaries. So as you can see on this slide, there are several types of cyber attacks. And the reason I picked cyber attacks is that it's relevant to attribution and it's part and parcel for the reason we're all here today. So what do we know about cyber attacks? Well, we know that they're imminent, right? And that they occur on a global basis, and their impact is significant, and as we've clearly seen through the media of recent times. They're complex in the sense that they can be both sophisticated and unsophisticated. They vary in origin, with criminal elements launching global cyber attacks, subnational entities such as agenda-driven hacktivists launching cyber attacks or cyber mercenaries launching cyber attacks on behalf of other entities, as well as state-sponsored activity. They're detrimental to brands, to enterprises, to livelihoods and economies, and to our way of life in many respects. So in a report that was conducted by Rose McDermott from Brown University, titled Decision Making Under Uncertainty, Rose wrote about the fact that at its core, what's being attacked is really the concept of certainty itself. And that though assets, personnel, systems, ecosystems, and our confidence, which is placed heavily in the controls we leverage, are also being attacked, it's our psychological degree of certainty that's being compromised, that's under attack at its root. And I thought that was an interesting point, because most of the time we tend to dismiss the soft sciences and the hard sciences, especially when it relates to information security. So it's our beliefs and our understanding with respect to our threat posture and our risk posture that's under attack, and it's our confidence level in those things that we place our belief and our trust in to protect us against threat agents or threat actors that's really coming under attack and scrutiny. So because of this attack on certainty, it's easy to lose perspective and clarity with regards to attribution, and that's an important thing to consider. Our vision can be clouded with respect to attribution and to threat actor profiling if we don't maintain a degree of focus. So as a result, these attacks are of greater importance than I think they've been previously considered. And as we'll see as we progress through the slides, we'll discuss how some of that manifests. Okay, so what is attribution? Attribution is one of the greatest challenges that we face as analysts, investigators, defenders, law enforcement, and governments in the world today from an information security perspective. Why is it such a challenge? Anyone hazard a guess? No? Okay. Fair enough. Well, it's a challenge due to the state of the internet and it being a stateless environment. We never know who at any given point in time is connecting to the internet, for what purpose, why, and how. Or we don't know with definitive certainty, right? The volume of data, the voluminous volume of data that's contained within the internet makes it almost impossible, if not definitively impossible, to analyze at any one given time, which subsequently does not allow us to establish the who, what, where, when, and how, and why at any given one point in time on a global basis for all threat actors. The price of admission is right. Anyone today can access the internet, right? Now more than ever before in our history has the availability of broadband communications and mass communications as a whole been readily at our fingertips. And this allows for both traditional users of the internet, those who seek knowledge to use that, as well as non-traditional, maliciously driven users to take advantage of the internet and use it for as a means to an end. And lastly, it's the perfect hiding place if you want to carry out something of a malicious nature. It's probably the most, if not the most, certainly within the most perfect environments to perpetuate the notion of plausible deniability. And that's, I think, an important concept, especially as we start talking about attribution chain analysis and the establishment of attribution. So on the screen before you see a definition of attribution, and it's really the assignment of ownership of a threat act or action to a threat actor or agent or group. Were we to borrow definitions from the discipline of psychology, we would see that there are two definitive definitions, explanatory attribution and interpersonal attribution. So explanatory attribution answers the question why someone does one thing or another, why threat actor A launches an attack against corporation B. Interpersonal attribution, on the other hand, answers the question why something occurs when two or more causes are present, why personnel A is being compromised at the same time that system B is being compromised, and by whom, right, from an attribution perspective in our terminology, translating that from the psychological discipline. So as we can see, it's not a trivial matter, and it requires a great deal of work and time and energy and effort, in addition to a great deal of evidence, in addition to collaboration between local law enforcement, municipal law enforcement, government, federal law enforcement, researchers, investigators, and all points in between on a global basis. It's also important to note that our potential for our proclivities to cloud our vision remains at a constant within the context of attribution analysis and establishment. You know, attributing identity can lead to an inference of intention, and that's an important thing to bear in mind when you're conducting this type of analysis. We have a tendency to want to infer, based on a small subset of data, what our threat actors or our adversaries are actually doing from an intent perspective, and that can be dangerous in that we don't have a composite picture or view with respect to their actual actions. So if we don't understand their psychological posture and we don't understand their motives from a TTP perspective, we can fall short and subsequently cut off our noses to spite our face. Okay, so types of attribution. At a very high level, there are two types of attribution, technical attribution as well as human attribution. That kind of descends into the four concepts that you see on the screen before you, ownership from a machine perspective or an asset perspective, asset or ownership-driven attribution, location-driven attribution from a geointelligence perspective, which are both technological in nature, threat actor or agent attribution, and then the aggregate identity of individuals or groups from an attribution perspective, which is also human. So in order to begin establishing attribution, we need to establish a few things, right? We need to talk about technological attribution, human attribution, and that begs the question, does the latter truly matter? And this is where a lot of debate comes into play within our industry. Does attribution of a threat actor actually matter, or is it more important to focus on the threat itself? And I think this is a debate that's been raging for probably 15, 20 years, if not longer. Certainly within the information security space, but also going into the conventional warfare space, right? Does it really matter who's behind the attack, or does it matter that we're being attacked? That's right. It can be broken down a little bit more, right? We can talk about the who, the what, the where, the when, the how, the frequency of attack, stages of attack from an IOC perspective and a campaign perspective, evidence and artifacts that can be derived from this type of activity, and threat actor and agent profiling, and also affiliation. Oops, something's going on back there. So this leads us to establish concrete attribution in the following manner. We need to talk about agreement and what that means for with respect to multiple parties and corroboration of data. Uniqueness, signatures of threat actors and adversaries, approaches to targets of opportunity and interest, IOCs, and being very cognizant of the false flag and the threat that poses when we're conducting attribution, right? Obfuscating one's own identity or a group's identity and purposefully manufacturing or leveraging the identity of another group to conduct an operation. Additionally, we need to consider regularity and what that means from a frequency and repetition perspective. So we gain a distinct advantage through attribution chain establishment. We gain the opportunity to share intelligence on a global basis amongst research communities, intelligence operator communities, law enforcement, and governments. And why is this important? Well, this is important because it allows us to create a better purview of our threat ecosystem and address our attack surface in a greater and more efficient manner. We gain the opportunity to better prepare ourselves for attack. And I can't think of a better better use of attribution than to do just that from an active defense perspective. Even though active defense tends to mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people. I think this thing's falling off my ear, sorry. We also gain the opportunity to seek prosecutorial action, which I think is very important. When you're whether you're chasing criminals with the express intent of bringing down a botnet, or chasing criminals to from a fraud perspective who are involved in large-scale credit card fraud, or whether you're looking at spam operators or subnational entities who are working in some criminal capacity on behalf of a greater threat actor, such as a nation state, sharing intelligence and gaining an understanding of attribution can allow us to seek prosecutorial action and leverage the fullest extent of the law, both here in the United States and in other parts of the world, which is very important. It gives organizations an opportunity to expressly address their threat adversary and take the fight to the adversary. So takeaways. Attribution is often discussed from a human intelligence perspective, but not always in that context. And a greater degree of emphasis needs to be placed on the human aspect of attribution, because we oftentimes focus on IOCs and things such as IP addresses, domains, artifacts, malware, et cetera, et cetera. It's often misunderstood, and I think it's potentially one of the greatest or most misunderstood concepts in our industry today. And there's so much debate with respect to attribution and its value that it warrants greater degrees of discussion from a comprehension perspective. What does it truly mean to establish attribution? Is it important in the grand scheme of things? Is it intrinsic in conducting an analytic investigation? And is it, ultimately speaking, important to know who's banging away at the keyboard in a disparate part of the world? Or does that matter at all? It's not easy to perform, right? Who here has ever conducted an attribution analytic investigation? Anyone? All right. It's probably one of the most cumbersome and challenging things you can do in this space, largely because there's such a great degree of fault to contend with, and there are so many ways to obfuscate one's identity that the process in and of itself is laborious and at the same time confounding, while also being invigorating if you're an investigator. It's also important to bear in mind that the importance of linkages between when establishing attribution, and especially when we start talking about certainty again. All these points really are dependent upon our certainty and our confidence in the threat mitigation technologies and controls we put into place. And linkages help establish a stronger degree of certainty in what we've already done and what we intend to do with regards to threat actors and agents. And perhaps last but not least, a mature approach to attribution can lead to a solid and effective deterrence model that can be used for a number of different purposes, most notably active defense. So at this point, I guess I'll open for questions. No questions? I guess they don't want questions.
Thank you, Will.
Thank you. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I guess I can take your question offside.